Thank you, Mr. Chairman, for your introduction. And thank to my jury to come here to evaluate my PhD work. And thanks to everyone to come here and over Zoom. So today I will present my PhD work with the title of The Impact of Melt Supply on Fault Distribution, Volcanism, and Thermal Region at Those Red Ridge. And this visit is supervised by Madhya Ganat. So here is the outline. At first, I will introduce the background and the research purpose of my thesis, which has three parts. In part one, I study a magmatical robust endmember at the ultraslow spreading ridge at the SWIR, South-Western India Ridge, 50 degrees, 28 minutes east. And in part two, I studied a nearly amagmatic endmember at the same ridge of the 64 degrees, 30 minutes east. And based on the observations in two melt supply endmembers, I used a numerical thermal model to explore the variability of the thermal structure at the slow and ultra-slow spread ridges. In the end, I will have my general conclusions. So the global mid-ocean ridge hidden by the ocean, which consists of a volcanic chain extending to more than 60,000 kilometers. And the oceanic lithosphere is created at the mid-ocean ridge as the melt upwards ground mantle and in response to plate separation. So at the fastest spreading ridge, here I give the example of East Pacific rise 9 degrees. So the seafloor is characterized by axial highs, and there is a very shallow axial melt lines at only 1.5 kilometers. And it's at the top of a hot crystal mesh zone. And the morphology of the seafloor here is very flat, which is called smooth seafloor morphology, composed of high eruption rate, low bed, and sheet lavas. And this high eruption rate lava mainly relate to the very shallow and robust magmatism in this area. And the faults and fissures are very small and very few at the fastest spreading ridge. That means the plate separation is mostly accommodated by magmatism in this area. But at the slow and ultra slow spreading ridge, melt supply is overall reduced, but it's more variable. And in some melt core regions, here I take the example of the slow spreading mid-Atlantic ridge, 30 degrees north. And in this area, the seafloor is spreading is accommodated by detachment fault up to more than 50%. And this detachment fault has a low angle of emergency, which is called oceanic core complex, OCC. And we can see as the its conjugate plate is accommodated by volcanism and high angle normal faults. So this asymmetrical spreading is called detachment volcanic spreading mode. And here I click a profile across the detachment faults. We can see the earthquakes are more active at the in the fault wall, and there is nearly zero earthquake in the honey wall. So this earthquake pattern shows a high angle fault angle in the deep area and rotate to a low angle in the shallow zone. And this process exhume deep gabbros and peridotites onto the seafloor to make the OCC. When melt reduces to nearly zero at a specific region, at ultra-slow spreading is around 64 degrees. And in this area, the seafloor spreading is almost 100% accommodated by detachment faults. And in this cross-axis profile, we can see the youngest detachment D1 in red cuts the older detachment fault of D2 in purple, and with changing priorities. And with the same approach, we can see D2 cuts the much older detachment of D3, and D3 cuts D4 with changing priority. So this pattern of faulting is called successive flip flow. detachment spreading mode. And at the younger detachment D1, with seafloor reflectivity and samples, we can see on the surface of foot wall and honey wall, both of them expose 39 cladodites. So, and with only a few homotopy basalts. So this one is different from the previous volcanic detachment spreading mode. And in this VP velocity profile, we can see VP almost linearly increase with the depth and with no indication for the crust layer 2 and layer 3. So in this case, the crust may be made of 79 cladodites, and the P wave velocity increase with the subtilization decrease. But there are also some merit rich segments at slow and ultra slow spread rates. The lucky strike is a well studied segment at the middle attempted reach. And this is the ridge edge. And here at the second center, we can see a topographic high relative to the second end. And this high is a central domal volcano. And we can also see the rifted domal volcano in the off X regions. And in the along X profile, we can see this the crustal thickness between the seafloor and the molehole is increasing from the second end to the second center. This pattern is called the long X melt focusing. And there is a actual melt lines seismic reflector at 3.5 kilometers here. And just beneath the actual melt lines, there is a seismic low velocity anomaly. And this configuration can be interpreted as a crystal mass zone in the lower crust, like the fastest spreading ridges. And in this across X profile, we can see the crustal thickness is almost constant at 7.5 kilometers. And then another well studied melt rich segment is SWIR 50 degrees east. It has similar feature to the lucky strike. And this is the long X. And there is also a central domal volcano and a rifted domal volcano in the off X region. And in this long X profile, there is also a melt focusing pattern with a low velocity seismic anomaly in the lower crust. But in the cross X profile at the central center, the crust thickness is constant, but it's extremely thick at 9.5 kilometers. And from this recent compilation of the crust thickness and the half spread rate, the SWIR 50 degree is the thickest crust of the, almost all the middle ocean reefs away from the hotspots. So to better understand the role of the melt pipe, in my thesis, I focus on two study areas with extremely different melt pipe of ultraslow spread reefs. From the most magmatically robust endmember at SWIR 50 to the nearly amagmatic endmember of the SWIR 64 degree. So the very big, in this case, I'm able to study the impact of the melt pipe on the fault, volcanism, and sub-region of slow and ultraslow reefs. And the variability of the fault and volcanism and sub-region should be ideally blanketed by two endmembers. So now let's go to look at the details of the part one. This melt-rich segment has been intensively investigated by French cruises in the 1990s, and many Chinese annual cruises over the last 15 years. And in my thesis, I use the recent collected near seafloor data at the second center, which cover 780,000 years of seafloor here. And I use the 2 meter high resolution bathymetry and back scanner with two near Bolton magnetic profiles. And this data is captured by the Qianlong 2 AUV, which is made in China. And I also use 6 long X sections of seafloor photographs for the ground truth collected by these digital cameras. So this map is the 3D view of a high resolution bathymetry. And the most prominent feature is two elevated regions here and here. And they are cut by a pair of conjugates, not a large force, NF1 and SF1. And these two elevated regions is part of a rifted normal volcano, as I show you in the shipboard bathymetry data. And from this map, I'm able to identify different types of seafloor morphology. For example, this extensive flat seafloor is called smooth seafloor. And in this area, it's, the seafloor is much more bumpy and rough. So this is a conical seafloor. And in the smooth seafloor, we can see that it usually covers a large area, and maybe the because of the lava flows, eruption very, very fast and move far away from the eruption centers. And we can see in the close-up view, that we can see the front of the lava flows and the lava tubes and lava channels. And they transport lava from the eruption center to other places. And these features are more common at the fastest spreading ridges. And for the homogeneous seafloor, we can see many volcanic cones, and this lava may be erupted in a slower rate, and it cannot be moved from the eruption center. And they are usually connected to the long X homogeneous ridges. And then between the homogeneity and the smooth, I give a middle type of smooth homogeneity. And it's here it's relatively smooth, but it still has some small kind of cones. And except from for the volcanic features, the linear feature like fault scarps and fissures are also identified in this map. I will show you later. So I first made this seafloor morphology map. The smooth seafloor is in the pale blue, mostly in the center of the map. And homogeneity in the deep blue, which is mostly in the southwest of this map. And the middle blue is smooth homogeneity. And from the seafloor photographs, I can identify different types of the lava morphology, like pillow lava, elongated pillow, and low bit lava, and different types of sheet lavas. And we can see their surface is getting flatter from the pillow to the low bit and sheet and flat sheet lava. So here I relate the lava morphology to the eruption rate, and the flat sheet lava has highest eruption rate. Of course, the lava morphology do not 100% depend on the eruption rate, but it's the most important factor at the mid ocean ridge. So to compare the map scale seafloor morphology and the photo scale lava morphology, I did this study state for lava morphology of photographs at each type of seafloor. So we can see from homogeneity, smooth homogeneity, and smooth, as all the photographs I did a study state. We can see the pillow low bit in middle blue and the sheet lava in pale blue. Is increasing from homogeneity to smooth seafloor. But the pillow lava in deep blue is decreasing from homogeneity to the smooth lava flow. That means the average eruption rate is increasing from homogeneity to smooth. This is shows the consistency between the map scale seafloor morphology and the photo scale lava morphology. And in this entire area, the proportion of low bit and sheet lava is 41% against 59%. And I will use this value to compare with other mid-ocean ridge settings. So the second map is the fault scarp and the fissures. Here I also identify the facing of the faults. So this line, which is the fault facing transition line, that means I separate most of the source facing faults in the north. North of this line and the north facing force in the south of the line. And this line is maybe the present day tectonic center. And this, this green area is the fracture density calculated from the faults and fissures. So here I can easily identify the Hamaki fracture-free domain in the center of the map and near the fault spacing transition line. And if we look at the near bottom magnetic profiles, this domain Hamaki fracture-free corresponds to magnetic anomaly heights. And in this area, the pillow lava is very fresh and with very few sediments. So I would say this Hamaki fracture-free domain it may be produced by the most recent volcanic eruptions. And it extends from the west to the east, but stopped by extensive faults. And we can, this is maybe the most recent tectonic activity in this area. Then I also use the 14 this 14 map to estimate the tectonic strain along five across X profiles from P1 to P5. Here in the sketch, I measure each fault slow and along the all the profile and accumulate from the north to the south. So we can see from north to south it's increasing. Then I give a range of a mean fault deep to calculate the heave of the cumulative heave of the faults, and then divided by the profile lines. As a result, the apparent tectonic strain is 3.6 to 7.7%. But this value is the minimal estimation because we don't know the faults covered by the lava, the later lava flows. Here, I compilate a global distribution of lava morphology and tectonic strain with respect to spread rate. So the lava morphology is shown as the relative proportion of low-bed sheet lava and the pillow lavas. So we can see the proportion of low-bed sheet lava is roughly increased from the from slow and ultra-slow rate to the faster rates. And we can see the severity degree in red has the highest proportion of slow and ultra-slow ridge. And for the tectonic strain, there is no function of tectonic strain with respect to spread ridge, but the slow and ultra-slow ridge, they have highest variability than upper faster ridge, and our stat area, severity degree, has the lowest tectonic strain. So combined with the thickest crust of the middle ocean ridge with a lower crustal mass zone, I would say the SWIR 50 degree is really the most magmatically robust and member at the slow and ultra-slow ridges. But here, this robust magmatism is not constant over time. So based on the geological mapping, I identify six groups of eruptive phases from V1 to V5, from old to young. V1, we can see this is the rifted domal volcano, and this is its boundary. And we can see there is mostly smooth seafloor with very few faults. Here I reconstruct the V1 domal volcano like this. And its upper, its back injection zone should be localized to the spreading center. And the domal volcano is piled up by smooth lava flow layers. And the V1 was cut by a pair of conjugate normal faults, NF1 and SF1, which was the beginning of V2. So here I also sketched the early stage of V2. We can see in V2, it's mostly homarchy eruptions in deep blue, and its dive injection zone should be delocalized because most of V2 seafloor is observed to the source of the SF1, which is here. And the V2 seafloor between the NF1 and the SF1. It's maybe again, this is the SF1 and NF1. It's maybe covered by extensive smooth outflow of V3 like this in pale blue. And also, again, this small slab flow has very few faults and a high eruption rate. So its upper crustal construction should be similar to the V1 with a localized direct injection zone. And we do not see the smooth lava flow to the source. So it's maybe again covered by V4 and the V5 in the later. So V4 is homogeneous seafloor with extensive force on the surface. And V5 is the homogeneous fracture free domain that I proposed before. And it has very few faults, but it's small and new, so it's maybe part of V4 eruptive phase. So V4 and V5, they should have similar upper crustal construction than V2, with delocalized direct injection zone. So here we can see there is a cyclic change of upper crustal construction. V1 and V3, they are in the waxing phase and with higher mass supply, so to produce a higher eruption rate, smooth lava flow, and with only a few faults. And V4, V2, and V5, they are in the waning phase of mass supply, which has lower mass supply with homogeneity reach, and so there are more faults to accommodate more faults on the seafloor. And to constrain the time duration of the cycle, I use the age of the blooms. This area, I sketch it here. This bloom is 780,000 years. And I also take some spread distance like between the conjugate NF1 and SF1 to get the spreading age. As a result, a complete cycle it has about 300,000 years. So here I draw the two conceptual models across X of the thermal structure for the cyclic mass supply. And I relate the seafloor morphology to the lower crustal magmatic system. And the dashed line are isotherms. These concepts are mostly taken from the interpretation of fast spread reefs. So during the waning phase, which is also the present day phase before, the frequency of melt injection is lower, and the AMR should be deeper than the waxing phase, which the waxing phase has a higher frequency of melt injection. So it's hotter to host a shallow AMR. In this case, the brittle lithosphere is thinner and hotter than the waning phase. However, this cyclic change of mass supply does not change the crustal thickness of 9.5 kilometers, maybe because of the ultraslow spread rate, dampening the crustal variation with a period of a few hundred thousand years. And based on the present day conceptual thermal model, and combine the seismic velocity anomaly and located earthquakes, and able to constrain the present day magmatic system. In this sketch, along the recent eruption, mass supply increased towards the second center from end to the center with the crustal thickness change. And the low velocity anomaly at the second center is interpreted as a crystal mesh zone with abundant melt lines. This also taken from the interpretation of faster spreading ridges. And I also draw the base of the brittle lithosphere above the mesh zone and delocalize the dynamic injection zones. So, and after this, the investigation and interpretation for this magmatic robust and member. In the next part, I will move from the very hot area to a completely different world, very cold, nearly amagmatic and member at a square 64 degree. So in this part, I'm working on the micro seismicity around the on-X detachment fault. This is the younger detachment fault, and it has been imaged by a seismic reflection. And in this interpretive sketch, it shows many damage zones in the footwall and gives a limit of the detachment fault line. And there are some seismic reflectors in the honey wall and mostly facing to the detachment fault. And here I use two different OBS deployments. The first OBS network is in these blue triangles deployed during the seismic small screws recording 8 days of micro earthquakes. And the second OBS network in orange square deployed during the RV small screws for 19 days of the micro earthquakes. So here I directly show you the results of about 300 earthquakes, which are located with the 1D velocity model at the same area. And the earthquakes are located by the non-log software and relocated by hypocentral double difference, hypo-DD. And this figure shows earthquake epicenters. Blue and the orange circles are from the different OBS deployments. And the earthquakes we can see are mostly within the actual valley. And the most focal mechanisms are shown as normal faulting. And the depth range of the earthquakes is between 0 to 15 kilometers. That means the seismogenic lithosphere in this area is at least 15 kilometers thick. And here I show you two earthquakes profiles, P2, P2 prime and P3, which are here. And along the P2, earthquakes occur almost along the detachment of fault trees. And this consists with the seismic reflector that I showed you in last slide. And in this P3, there are not too many earthquakes along the fault trees. There are is a cluster of earthquakes in the honey wall. And with the focal mechanisms I project in this profile, we can see it has about 50 degree foot deep and facing to the detachment fault and consists with the geometry of the seismic reflectors. But this honey wall earthquakes are very few at the more magmatic detachment fault, like Mars 30 degree north, nearly no earthquake in the honey wall, and also the same pattern in the southwest in the ridge dragonfly. Otherwise, I also observed a seismic swarm in these green circles just on the PQ profile, which are here. And this swarm occurred within 2 days. And I especially separate them into three clusters. The first cluster in the shallow domain and near the detecting fault line. And the other two clusters are deep east in square and deep west in triangle. And we look at the triangle earthquake, we can see there is an upward migrating over time. And there are three events, last event, they just beneath the volcanic hierarchy. So here is my, I interpret it as there may be an upward migrating melt intrusion in the detachment fault wall, and then trigger a sequence of shallow tectonic earthquake in the detachment fault line. And there is a compilation of seismogenic lithosphere versus spreading ridge. And this figure is modified from the preliminary et al. 2019. The base of the seismogenic lithosphere is maybe controlled by isotherm, and it's interpreted by the numerical thermal model by Morgan and Chen in 1993. And the depth of this isotherm decrease with the spreading rate decrease, increase as spreading decrease. And if this isotherm fits the most of the slow spreading ridge very well, but it's not working well with the actual slow spreading ridges. And if the melt is the mean heat carrier to the lithosphere, the nearly-amagmatic actual slow spreading ridge square 64 degree should have a very thick lithosphere, but actually and spreadly, it's not, even no thicker than the more magmatic square dragonfly. Which has 18 kilometers seismogenic lift, and they have the same spread rate and the same reach. So in this case, I will with this this modeling challenge to the next part. In this part, we first look at the previous model. This one is Morgan and Chen in 1993 and Tyson Carr 2011. And they also all predict the thermal structure, cause and spread rate decrease. And they actually measure line depth of most of the fast and intermediate spread rate are consistent with the model prediction. But if I put two mass supply and members of ultraslow spread rate, they are completely off from this prediction. So what controls the large variability of the thermal region at slow and ultraslow reach? And I also want to explore how does the thermal region change with cyclic mass supply at 1250 degree in the part one? And why the seismogenic lift is at 1260 degree is no thicker than the more magmatical jagged line with the same spread rate in part three, in part two, sorry. And with these motivations, I used a new 2D coupled model designed for slow and ultra-slow spread rates by Fan et al. The main idea of the model is the balance between heat input by mass supply and the heat output by hydrothermal cooling. And the hydrothermal system in this model is controlled by a density flow in a uniform permeable layer and the cut of the hydrothermal system. And in the magmatical system, the melt is repeatedly amplified as a 4 kilometer wide and 500 meter thick lines, which amplified beneath the 1,000 degree isotherm. And this isotherm is regarded as the basaltic solids. And the melt flux is a variable adjusted by the time interval of melt injection, and which can be described by this equation. So in this equation, higher time interval of melt injection correspond to a lower melt flux with a constant area shape. So, and also there are three observable interests which can be observed by our geophysical or near seafloor observations. The first one is hydrothermal valley temperature, and the last and two isotherms are 650 and 1000 degree. The 650 isotherm is a brittle ductile transition, which is defined by the base of the seismogenic lithosphere, and 1000 degree is a brittle basaltic solids, which can outline the mass zone defined by the AM depth or the seismic lowvelocity anomaly in our model. So now they run this model with changing the time interval of melt injection and mainly look at the melt pool ultra-slow spreading regions at the middle climate spread center and the dragonfly of the swell. Here they predict the 10 kilometer thick seismogenic lithosphere at the middle climate with the time interval tau at 50,000 years. And for the thicker lithosphere of 18, at the dragonfly, they also predict with a 100,000 year time interval. So, but both model predict a very low hydrothermal band. And as we know, at this dragonfly, there are a number of high temperature black smokers. So, here in my thesis, I first do a similar runs for changing the melt flux. This is melt flux equation, and I relate the crustal thickness HC and the time interval of melt injection with a constant spread rate of the swell 14 millimeter per year and the same melt line shape. So from the left to the right, the crust thickness is from 0 to 9.5. These two end members are taken from the previous two parts at 64 and 50 degrees. So, and the time interval is from the infinity decrease to the 6,000 years. And it's not surprising that the high melt flux produce hotter thermal region and hotter hydrothermal band. At the extra 50 degree, we can predict a crustal mushroom limited by this 1,000 degree isotherm. But none of these models can really predict the coexistence of the thick seismogenic lithosphere and high temperature hydrothermal band like the dragonfly. So here I introduce a new parameter of the modeling, which is temperature of host rock upon melt and placement, TR. So in this case, melt can be injected into any depth within the lithosphere. For example, it can be injected in beneath 650 isotherm or the 1000 degree isotherm, or I can inject the melt, stack the two melt beneath two isotherms. And this concept was proposed very early by Mathieu in 1990s. And in this concept, if the hot melt is injected into very cold host rocks, high temperature hydrothermal circulation should be produced around the melt. So with this concept, I run these three models, which has the same melt flux as crustal thickness of 9.5 kilometers. And in the first model, I repeatedly amplify all the melt beneath 1,000 degree. And in the second, amplifies the shallow at 650 isotherm. And in the last one, it's more extreme with melt amplifies beneath 400 degree isotherm. So we can see the hydrothermal system is getting hotter, and it can produce more than 300 degree hydrothermal band. But the lower lithosphere is getting cooler. So in this case, at a given melt flux, a melt injection into colder host rock produce more efficient hydrothermal heat extraction, but a colder thermal region. And in this most extreme case, TR 400 degree, its lower lithosphere is even close to a no melt condition. That's around in previous rounds. And this model provide a potential explanation for the deep earthquakes at Dragonfly and also a high temperature event. And in this model, I separate the AML into two half thick stacked AMLs. I call it half and half. And I amplify the half melt to 650 and 1000 degree isotherm respectively. And we can see both hydrothermal system and the lower lithosphere are relatively hot with the crustal mushroom. And I will use this configuration for the next rounds to test the hydrothermal system. So the hydrothermal situation is mainly controlled by the cut of the hydrothermal system and the permeability. And these three models are also again with the same melt flux. And we can see from left to right, I give a deeper hydrothermal domain from A to B and a higher permeability from B to C. That means from A to C, there may be more and more tectonic activities. So we can see the thermal region is overall shifted down and getting cooler and cooler. But the hottest hydrothermal vent is not produced by the first one, it's produced by the middle model, which has a deeper hydrothermal system and lower permeability. And here, after testing the hydrothermal system, I will use this configuration to run the cyclic melt supply. So here I give a time interval of melt injection for the waxing phase at 3,000 years. So it has a higher melt flux. And for the waning phase, It had 12,000 years, so it had lower mass than their flux. And as we know, the time average of time interval to produce 9.5 kilometer sea crust corresponds to 6,000 years. So I can calculate the duration of waxing and waning with a complete cycle of 300,000 years. So if I give a different configuration of time interval of tall waxing here at 3 to 5 and tall waning 8 to 12, I can get different durations of the waxing or waning phase. But here I only show you this example with the highest amplitude of the time interval. So this is the time series of the depth change of 650 and 1000 degree SSM. I first run the model with time interval of 6 to make sure the thermal region is steady state, and then alternate the waxing and waning phase. And this model predicts an oscillatory thermal region. And during the waxing phase, in red, the thermal region is warmed up rapidly and almost reaches steady state. And there are three snapshots from left to right. You can see the isotherm going up. And during the waning phase, in blue, the isotherm are beating down, and it cools slowly. And it doesn't have enough time to get the steady state in this green line. So this cyclic change of mass flight also provide perspectives on lower crustal construction. And during the waxing phase, newly injected melt, it should reheat the base of the crystal sheeted diet. And in this case, the gabbros may assimilate the recrystallized sheeted diet like this. And during the waning phase, the newly injected melt migrates downward, so the later dike may cross-cut previously crystallized gabbros like this, but these ground truths are from the ophiolite, which is a kind of faster spread ridge with shorter durations on the cyclic mass flight. And unfortunately, there is no sample of the lower crustal at the mass ridge segment of the ultraslow ridge. So here is the conclusion. The most magmatically robust SWIR 50, it has a cyclic change of upper crustal construction, suggesting alternating waxing and waning phase of mass supply. At the SWIR 64 degree, it has at least 15 kilometers thick seismogenic lithosphere and active seismicity at both detachment, footwall, and honey wall. The numerical model shows highly variable thermal region at slow and ultraslow spread ridge, which are associated with melt supply, which is the frequency and depth of melt enrichment, as well as temporal change, and associated with hydrothermal secretion, which is the cutoff the depth and permeability of hydrothermal system. As for the prospect of my thesis, for the SWIR 50 degree, it's worth to make a more detailed 14 pattern and to calculate a max scale tectonic stream and the seismic reflection, if possible in the future, to make an experiment, it will provide strong evidence for the existence of the actual melt lines. And for the SWIR 64 degree, it's more like a question. If the deepest earthquake occurs at 600 to 700 degrees, why the semi brittle deformation occur at 800 to 1000 degrees based on the patchology of the variations? And is this semi brittle deformation undetectable by the OBS? Is our OBS duration too short to observe this deformation? As for this model, we should reconsider the thermal model for all middle ridge with the spreading rate, not only spread rate, but also melt flux, most of melt amplitude, and hydrothermal circulation. And the thermal effects of diets at melt rich and members should also be considered in my models. So thanks for your attention. That's all.